day everyone, welcome to the daily news analysis for December 17th. Let's look at the important news that are relevant for your CLAT and other law entrance examinations. Mostly we focus on legal news, any ruling by the Supreme Court, by the High Courts, by the tribunals, and then we also cover some important current affairs including your international affairs, economic affairs and so on and so forth. So let's see what are the important news that are relevant for December 17th. The first news is regarding this, what the Supreme Court, the Chief Justice of India is saying. He's saying that there will be no Supreme Court benches available during the winter vacation. There are so many cases pending, and this is the statement that is coming from the Chief Justice of India. Let's see what it says. Chief Justice of India, D.Y. Chandrachud, said on Friday that no vacation benches will be available in the Supreme Court during the winter break. The oral announcement came a day after Law Minister Kiran Rijiju reportedly criticized the long vacations of the court and the inconvenience it caused to litigates. If you have been following news, you must have heard that the Law Minister has criticized that there are so lengthy vacations in the courts and that is why so many cases are pending. And amidst that, the Chief Justice of India is saying that there will be no Supreme Court benches available during the winter vacation. However, according to a circular issued by the Supreme Court on September 29, a senior Supreme Court registry official is specially deputed as a vacation officer. This official could be approached by any advocate seeking urgent relief, either on court holiday or during after court hours. In such instances, a bench would be constituted if required. So if required, there will be a special vacation officer to take care of such a situation. Friday is the last working that is not relevant. What is relevant is how many cases are pending. There are 69,598 cases pending in the Supreme Court. The calendar for the year 2023 shows the court would not be fully functional for nearly 180 days, including weekends and holidays. The court's pendency as of December 1 is 69,598 cases. There are currently 6 judicial vacancies in the court. The past year had seen the court come out of hard days of the pandemic and take in on the increased pendency. Judges have been hearing 80 cases on some days, up to 100 cases a day. So vacation benches are, so please understand what are vacation benches. Vacation benches are special benches which the Chief Justice of India may designate during summer and winter holidays to hear urgent matters, which includes peace concerning bail, habeas corpus and other fundamental right issues. Rule 6 of Order 2 of the Supreme Court Rules 2013 provide that the Chief Justice may appoint one or more judges to hear during summer vacation or winter holidays all matters of an urgent nature which under these rules may be heard by a judge sitting singly, and whenever necessary, he may likewise appoint a division court for the hearing of urgent cases during the vacation, which required to be heard by a by the bench. So, this is the situation regarding the vacation bench. Chief Justice has the discretion; he can constitute a bench to hear the urgent matter, so that even during the vacation, the matters do not stop and especially the fundamental right issues, the bail issues, the habeas corpus issues, these would be heard. I hope everybody understands what is habeas corpus. Habeas corpus, whenever a person is illegally detained, the court may order the person to be released. The word habeas corpus means to produce the body. If someone is illegally detained, someone has not been presented before the magistrate within 24 hours, or the court finds that the person is not legally detained, he may order the release of that person. It is one of the writs, one of the 5 writs under Article 32 of the Constitution of India. The National Green Tribunal issues notice to Tamil Nadu government over Marina Pen Monument. So the Southern Bench of the National Green Tribunal issued a notice to the Tamil Nadu government over the proposed pen statue honoring late Dravid Munnetra Kazhagam Supremo and Karunanidhi off the coast of the Marina Beach. The NGT sought the state's response to a public interest litigation that said the monument might harm the marine ecosystem. While the Tamil Nadu Public Works Department approved the project, environmentalists have raised an alarm that the project would damage the coastal ecosystem. The proposed site for the Muthmes Arivnar Dr. Kalaignar Penn Monument falls under CRZ 1A, CRZ 2, CRZ 4A areas, and the estimated cost of the project is over 80 crore rupees. Since the proposed monument would be located around 360 meters of the Bay of Bengal from the Marina Beach coast, the state sought permission under Section 42J of the Coastal Regulation Zone, CRZ, notification amended in March 22, 2016. The Ministry of Environment, Forest, Climate Change has asked the state to submit the final Environmental Impact EMA report within 4 years on the DMK government's plan to construct the Kalaignar Penn Monument in the Bay of Bengal. So whenever construction activity goes on and here they are, this monument is being erected. So what is the impact of that on the ecosystem, on the marine ecosystem in this case? And these are the relevant bodies. So NGT has issued notice, then other relevant bodies, the Ministry of Environment, the Ministry of Forest, the Ministry of Climate Change, they have asked the state to submit the final Environment Impact Assessment, EIA, to assess whether it is harming the ecosystem or not. 1.3 terabyte data encrypted and 5 servers affected in AIIMS ransomware attack. So this you must have heard about this AIIMS attack that that happened recently. There was this ransomware attack. So based on current analysis by stakeholders concerned, about 1.3 terabyte data were encrypted in the recent ransomware attack on the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, that is AIIMS, information technology network by unknown theater actors, according to the government. In a written response to the question of Rajya Sabha member John Brithers, Minister of State for Electronics and Information Technology, Rajiv Chandrasekhar, said upon being informed about the cyber security incident, the Indian Computer Emergency Response, CERTIN, had done an evaluation. As per the analysis, servers were compromised in the information technology network of the AIIMS by unknown threat actors due to improper network segmentation, which caused operational disruption due to the non-functionality of critical applications. CERT and other stakeholders entities have advised the necessary remedial measures, it was said in the reply. Now, based on the analysis by concerned stakeholders, 5 servers of the AIIMS were affected and approximately 1.3 terabyte of data were encrypted. Mr. Chandrasekhar also said that CERT, which is mandated to track and monitor cyber security incidents in India, had issued a special advisory on security practices to enhance resilience of health sector entities, which had been communicated to the health ministry for sensitizing health sector entities regarding the latest cyber security threats. Replying to another question, Minister of State for Health and Family Welfare, Bharti Praveen Pawar, said all the data for e-hospital has been retrieved from a backup server and restored on new servers. So this attack has really raised an alarm that how safe are these, because AIIMS is the one of the top institutes for medical and healthcare in the country. If that is being attacked by the ransomware, by the threat actors, how safe is our of the data that are of the data that is there in there for the health, as far as health is concerned for the Indians? So this is not very relevant news, but still the after events are relevant. That what are the consequences of this ransomware attack? Supreme Court to examine Andhra Pradesh government's plea seeking division of property. The assets valued at 1,42,601 crore include 245 institutions and corporations specified under the 9th and 10th schedule of Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Act 2014. The Supreme Court agreed to examine a petition which was filed by the Andhra Pradesh government seeking a fair, equitable and expeditious division of assets and liabilities with Telangana. A bench led by Sanjeev Khanna, a senior advocate K. Vishwanathan, and advocate Mafsooz Naski for Andhra Pradesh to serve copies of the petition to the union and Telangana government. The court said it would take up the case after the winter vacations. The state said that the assets include 245 institutions and corporations as specified under the 9th and 10th schedules of the Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Act. As you remember, that Telangana separated from the Andhra Pradesh as a separate state. So during that separation, what was the division of property, that is still in dispute. So regarding that, this petition is there. The total value of the fixed assets of the 245 institutions to be divided is about 1,42,601 crore rupees. Non-division of the assets is clearly to the benefit of Telangana, since about 91% of these assets are situated in Hyderabad, which is the capital of the erstwhile combined state, which was the Andhra Pradesh when Andhra Pradesh was with Telangana. So Hyderabad had most of these properties. Andhra Pradesh government has submitted this. The state said, despite the bifurcation on June 2, 2014, the actual division of assets and liabilities has not even commenced till date, despite repeated efforts by the government of Andhra Pradesh seeking a speedy resolution. Despite a lapse of more than 8 years, Andhra Pradesh was situated in Delhi, Andhra Bhavan situated in Delhi has not been formally bifurcated. The petition has said this. It said Hyderabad, now a part of Telangana, was the capital of the combined state of Andhra Pradesh. The non-apportionment of the assets has led to a multitude of issues adversely affecting and violating the fundamental and other constitutional rights of the people of the state of Andhra Pradesh, including over 1.59 lakh government employees. So there is still clarity has to be sought regarding the division of the property, and Supreme Court will examine this issue. This is the Andhra Pradesh government's plea, which is seeking the division of property, most of which falls in Hyderabad, which is now in the Telangana region. Supreme Court exists to protect personal liberty and rights. This has been observed, this has been said by the Chief Justice of India. So the Chief Justice of India, D.Y. Chandrachud, has said that the Supreme Court exists to hear every cry for personal liberty and fundamental rights. The main purpose of the court is the exercise of its jurisdiction as a protector of fundamental right to life and personal liberty in hearing in every citizen, the Chief Justice said in a judgment. The history indicates that it is in the seemingly small and routine matters involving grievance of citizens, that issue of movement, that is issue of moment, both in jurisprudential and constitutional terms, emerge the right to personal liberty is a precious and inalienable right recognized by the Constitution. In attending to such grievances, the Supreme Court performs a plain constitutional duty, obligation and function. This was written in the judgment. Chief Justice of India, Chandrachud, said the court could not afford to ignore even the faintest plea for personal liberty. If we do not act in manners of personal liberty and grant relief, then what are we doing here? This was said by the Chief Justice of India. The court was, in which case was this given? It was an electricity theft case. The court was hearing the plea of man, Ikram, who had spent a total of 18 years in jail for electricity theft. He was convicted in 9 separate cases of electricity theft for a period of 2 years each. His sentence was ordered to run concurrently. However, the prison authorities treated his sentence in each case to run consecutively, one after the other, for a total of 18 years. The Allahabad High Court had confirmed the view of the jail authorities. The Apex Court set aside the High Court's judgment and said Ikram's sentence would run concurrently. So it's not that after one term ends, he will be given another term, and then when that ends, he will be given another term. It will run concurrently. He did not spend 18 years in the prison for electricity theft. So that was the case. And in that case, he talked about the personal liberty and the rights and everything. China is expanding model villages in strategic areas. See, we have this phase of this China that is going on recently. A new village spread in 2 clusters is coming up near Siliguri corridor. Construction of new village is nearing completion in Churup area opposite to Uttarakhand, according to sources. So China is expanding such chain of model villages, moderately prosperous villages close to the line of actual control, where opposite Uttarakhand, Sikkim and Arunachal Pradesh, including in the Chumbi Valley, which faces the strategically crucial Siliguri corridor according to the defense sources. This in addition to continuing its infrastructure development and additional deployments along the line of actual control. At Pangda in the Chumbi Valley, where this village was set up earlier, a new village is coming up, spread in two clusters, while the presence of vehicles in the main cluster reveals its possible occupation in the other cluster. Also, there is increased vehicle activity and it is likely to be occupied soon. Similarly, opposite Uttarakhand, the construction of two villages in the Churup areas, located 11 km from the LAC, is nearing completion. Another model villages comprising of 35-36 dwellings in under construction on Kwangse, about 52 km from the line of actual control, which is also opposite the middle sector. Commenting on the situation on Yangtze, Eastern Army Commander Lieutenant General R.P. Kalita said on Friday that presently the border areas along the northern frontier are stable and we are firmly in control. A number of tunnels are under construction near the Pangda airfield, which are believed to be part of the railway line there, sources said. This is about 160 kilometers from the line of actual control opposite eastern Arunachal, rest of Arunachal Pradesh. So, there has been several news regarding in the last few days. Every time, whenever we do this newspaper reading, there is always some news regarding how China is acting near the line of actual control. So there has been some activity, and the activity is being monitored, and let's see how it turns out. Linking of Aadhaar and electoral ID is voluntary, says the Law Minister Kiran Rijiju. So terming the exercise to link Aadhaar with election photo identity card EPIC as voluntary, Law Minister Kiran Rijiju on Friday told the Lok Sabha that people who don't link their Aadhaar with EPIC will not be struck off from the voters list. It is voluntary, it is not mandatory, it is not compulsory. In response to another question on whether the government would consider banning opinion polls after the announcement of election schedule, the Law Minister replied in the negative that they will not be banning the opinion polls. Replying to a written question on linking of Aadhaar card with EPIC, Mr. Rijiju said, "The Election Laws Amendment Act 2021 allows electoral registration officers to require the existing or prospective electoral number for the purpose of establishing identity on a voluntary basis." He was responding to a question by Congress MP Pradyut Bordoloi, BSP's Ritesh Pandey and AIMIM's Sayyed Imtiaz Jaleel on the linkage of Aadhaar with electoral rolls. Asked whether the name of the voters whose voter IDs are not linked with Aadhaar will be struck off from the list, the minister said no. However, he made it clear that there is no provision for withdrawing the consent to share Aadhaar details. So once you have shared the Aadhaar details, now you cannot withdraw it. However, linking is not mandatory, it is voluntary. On Thursday, Mr. Rijiju had informed the Rajya Sabha that more than 55 crore of nearly 95 crore total voters have opted to link their Aadhaar details with voter ID. He said linking of Aadhaar is process driven and no targets have been given for linking Aadhaar with EPIC. So what is EPIC? EPIC is photo identity card. That is a photo election photo identity card is EPIC. The Election Commission does not store the Aadhaar numbers in its database. The Aadhaar numbers is based only for the authentication of the Election Commission, does not retrieve any personal information from the UIDAI Aadhaar database. This was mentioned by the Law Minister. The Sports Minister has unveiled the Hockey World Cup trophy before the legends. So as the nation gets ready to host the FIH World Cup Hockey from 13th January to 29th January at Bhubaneswar and Rourkela for the second edition in succession, promotional events are well. After Uttar Pradesh, Punjab and Haryana, it was the turn of Delhi to unveil the cup. In a symbolic gesture, Sports Minister Anurag Thakur unveiled the cup and handed it over to the 1975 World Cup winning captain Ajit Pal Singh at the Dhyan Chand Stadium here on this Friday. Team members Ashok Kumar, Ashok Devan, Vineet Kumar, H.S. Chimney, three-based Olympic medalist Harbinder Singh, 1980 Olympic gold medalist, gold winner Zafar Iqbal, and other illustrious players like Mohinder Pal Singh were among those honored on these occasions. Ashok Kumar, son of legendary Dhyan Chand and saucer of the title, winning the goal in the India in the 2-1 victory over Pakistan, shared anecdotes from India's campaign. So this is some sports news that you should be aware of, that we are having this FIH World Cup Hockey this January at Bhubaneswar and Rourkela, and the trophy has now been revealed. It is being revealed at several states. Now it was the turn of Delhi where the sports minister has revealed it. So that's all for the December 17 news. See you in the next video with the next news for the next day.